Good evening. We certainly are glad you're here at prayer meeting tonight, and I think that we have a very interesting and perhaps unusual topic tonight that we're going to be talking about. If you have an opportunity to see the slides that we have here in the chapel there at smyrna.org and also in the classroom, that can be downloaded as well as viewed at this time. But the title of our message tonight is The Spirit Rekindled. The Spirit Rekindled. And this is actually a short expository sermon on the whole book of Haggai. Two whole chapters, one of the smallest books of the Bible. But I assure you that it is worthy of a lot of time and a lot of effort. Do you know Haggai? Have you ever understood the book Haggai much or his message? You should. It's one of the most inspiring books in all the Bible, and certainly a book that is full of courage and full of hope. Haggai, the name actually means festive. And some people believe that he might have been given this name because he was born during one of the feast days, possibly maybe during Tabernacles or Day of Atonement. We don't really know. But Haggai, with Zechariah and Malachi, those last three books of the Bible, they were the three post-exilic prophets or minor prophets. That simply means that they were called to the prophetic office after the Babylonian exile. You remember that the children of Israel, they had prophets come to them, like Jeremiah and Isaiah before the exile, and in fact, even during the exile. But after they were in Babylon for 70 years, there were three different prophets that ministered to Israel, and Haggai was the first. His contemporary, Zechariah, came just a few months later, Malachi perhaps 100 years later or more. Nothing is known of Haggai except what's revealed in his book and two verses in the book of Ezra, which basically just state that he was there at certain times. Some believe that Haggai was so advanced in years that when he delivered his prophecies in his book, that he could remember the former temple because he spoke of the glory of the former temple and how this latter seemingly would not be as great, but in the end would actually be of greater vestige. Now let's think about the historical setting before we go on for just a minute. Cyrus the Great, he conquered Babylon, we know, in 539 B.C., he immediately instituted a policy of conciliation toward the religions of the conquered nations that he overtook. And this was shown also by his issuing the decree permitting the Jews to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem and for some of them to go back. Taking advantage of this decree, a comparatively small number of exiles under the leadership of a man by the name of Zerubbabel, who was a descendant of King David, they returned to their homeland and shortly afterward laid the foundation stone for what we call the Second Temple. Sometimes it's called Zerubbabel's Temple. Later it was refurbished by Herod and became known as Herod's Temple. Though their enemies attempted to stop the Jews from building the temple, the Lord provided them with the ability to continue. After a promising start on the Second Temple, the work gradually slowed down until it virtually ceased, owing mainly to the continual opposition and hindrance, mostly from the Samaritans. The discouraged exiles turned to working their own plots of land and to erecting living quarters for themselves. Little did those who mourned when the foundation of the Second Temple was laid realize how far their example would go into bringing discouragement of all who were endeavoring to restore the house of God. Turn with me to Ezra chapter 3 and verse 12. It says, but many of the priests and Levites and the chief of the fathers, who were ancient men, that had seen the first house, when the foundation of this house was laid before their eyes, wept with a loud voice, and many shouted for joy. Can you imagine that? They were weeping. And Haggai is called to the prophetic office at this time. And remember that again that the setting was that the children of Israel, they had been in Babylonian captivity there for how long? 70 years. And so some of these men, they might have been 8 or 10 years old, and so they've come back, they're starting to lay the temple, and they could have been possibly 80 years old, 85 years old, or they could have even been 74, 75, just seen as children, but they were clearly the ancient men. And so Cyrus the Great, again, brought forth a decree that they could go back and rebuild the temple. And yet the work began to stop. Now, Cyrus's son, Cambyses, allowed this to continue, but then after he died, Bordiaspulus, who was his brother or half-brother, came to the throne. Now, some people believe that he wasn't actually him, that he had actually been murdered while he was in Egypt. His brother had sort of sent him to Egypt because he had the feeling that he was going to try to take the throne from him. And while he was in Egypt, it's said that he was perhaps killed. He also went by the name Smyrtus. And so the one who actually took the throne sometimes is referred to as false Smyrtus, because they don't believe maybe he really was of that same line. But he only reigned during a short time, about a year. But during this time, he made a decree that the building of the temple should stop. And in fact, he was later described by Darius as a destroyer of temples. And when he took over the other Darius, then he encouraged them to go ahead and rebuild the temple, gave them a chance to start that off again. But then the people halted the work on the house of God, and they turned again their attention to their own dwellings and lands. And so the Lord, as it says in Haggai chapter 1, visited the people with a drought, and he confronted them with defeat in almost every plan that they had. And this went on for over a year, the temple being entirely neglected. And meanwhile, God was raising up people to help and bringing up his Spirit to speak to their hearts. And it was to meet these deplorable situations, this spiritual lethargy that Israel had come upon them, that God raised up Haggai, and especially also Zechariah at this time. And their messages were designed to bring messages of warning and reproof, of exhortation and encouragement. And they were designed to do something, and that was to arouse the people to action. If there was ever a time, friends, when we need messages that will arouse us to action, it is today. And so the work on the temple began in the second year of Darius. And we read about that in Haggai chapter 1. But it's interesting that it was only after the people, had actually begun to work on the temple again, trusting in the providence and protection of God, that Darius the king tried to emulate Cyrus, whom he seemed to have a great fondness for, in trying to offer up another decree to rebuild the temple. And this was confirmed and strengthened to the original decree of Cyrus that you read about in the book of Ezra. Now, quickly, the theme of the book. There are four main passages or messages in the book of Haggai. And I know that a lot of what we read and what we hear and what we remember about Haggai has to do with the building of the temple. If you remember, if we go to our next slide, Solomon's temple was tremendous in size, tremendous in splendor and beauty and grandeur. It was filled with gold and silver and bronze and cedar and wheat beyond measure almost. The most costly building that has ever been built in the history of humanity. But compared to the little temple, comparatively, that they built afterwards, it just, that little thing seemed like a nutcracker to them, perhaps. And so these elders, they didn't wait to see everything built. Once they saw the foundation, and they knew how small that foundation was compared to all that Solomon had laid, they realized this was going to be just a little thing, and it wouldn't have anywhere near the splendor or the glory that the former temple would have. But in the midst of this now, here comes Haggai. And in our next slide, we see outlined here the book of Haggai. And the first message is in the first chapter of Haggai, the first 15 verses. And interestingly, because of the chronology given in Haggai, the exact chronology, we can date probably within the very day that these messages were given. Isn't that interesting? And so his first message was given apparently on August the 29th of 520 BC, and then he added to it on the 21st of September, just about 3 weeks later. And then the second message comes in October, and the last two messages come in December of that same year. So Haggai's prophesying comes in a very quick and pointed way. Haggai realized the importance of the temple as a visible seat of God's presence and as the strong bond needed to hold the nation together in fidelity to the covenant and obedience to the law. Haggai encouraged the returning exiles to blend every effort toward rebuilding of the temple. In its entirety, as we look at all these messages, they are met with a more prompt and earnest response on the part of both the leaders and the normal people than that of any other prophet. We might think of a contrast with one of the prophets who came before the exile, and that was Jeremiah. Jeremiah was utterly and openly repudiated. And most of the prophets, in fact, encountered opposition, ranging from all the way from apathy through contempt and even persecution. But as it says in our next slide, in the Seventh-day Adventist Bible Commentary on Volume 4, page 1074, they make this interesting comment. Haggai stands forth as the most successful of the prophets if immediate compliance with his message may be considered the measure of a prophet's success. In other words, when Haggai prophesied, when he told, when he counseled, when he reproved Israel, they basically immediately joined in and said, we're going to do this. We're with you on this. And we're going to obey God. The noble example of those leaders and the people is one worthy of emulation by us today. It was a spirit of hearty cooperation that led within a remarkable short time to the completion of the Lord's house. And the same spirit will in our day lead to the completion of the spiritual house of God and the establishment of his eternal kingdom. Had the spirit manifested by the Jews in Haggai's day continued, the history of Israel would have been very different. Now, as I mentioned, this first message is found encapsulated in the first chapter. And in verses 3 through 6, we could just read some of these verses quickly here. If we turn to Haggai chapter 1. And I assure you, if you will study this book, you'll never look at it the same again. It's a fascinating book and worthy of your study. In verse 3, then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lie waste? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Ye have sown much and bring in little. Ye eat, but ye have not enough. Ye drink, but ye are not filled with drink. Ye clothe you, but there is none warm. And he that earneth wages to put into a bag with holes. In verses 4 and 5 in chapter 1, God asked these people to consider. He asked them to think about things. And I think that this is a very noble thing of God, because after all, who are we to even have to negotiate or to dialogue with God? Isn't it something that he would condescend down to speak to us in such terms? He who was worthy of just simply commanding obedience from us. He asked them, he says, is it time for you to dwell in these kind of houses? Shouldn't you consider this? Look at what's happening. You can't stay warm. You put your money in a pocket that's just full of holes. And you don't have anything to show for what's going on. You know, God is not unreasonable. In Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, he says, come now and let us reason together. Right? So God is a reasoning God. And he's one who's thoughtful of us and our needs. And he wants us to come to a decision. Because after all, we all know that it's much easier for someone to follow up on a decision that they make than to follow up on someone else's decision. Isn't that right? And so if we can come to see that we need to make these decisions, need to make these changes ourselves, God in his wisdom is trying to bring us to those places. And he did this even with Adam and Eve. If you think back in Genesis chapter 3, he came and walking in the cool of the day, and he said, Adam, where are you? Well, of course, he knew where he was. And he says, well, I was naked, Lord, and so I hid. And God said, well, how did you know you were naked? And so God, he enters into dialogue with us. And he comes down and meets us at a level that we can understand. But like many Americans today, they were working to put money into those bottomless pits, into those empty pockets. It seems like today, much of America, we work hard, we labor, we have two, sometimes three jobs, and still we hear the expression, I can't make ends meet. I can't save, or I have no retirement, whatever it might be, because there just is only so much money to go around. But in the time of Haggai, it wasn't that God didn't want to bless them. It wasn't that he didn't have plenty to provide them with. He later would say, all the silver and the gold is mine. But he was trying to help them to see the futility of their not putting him first. If we go to our next slide. There was a book written several years ago by a famous football player at the time. His name was Gale Sayers, one of the most electric running backs that ever played football. And it was entitled, I Am Third, because he said, God is first, others are second, I am third. And of course, we've probably all heard that little saying somewhere else, but he put it into a book. And actually became the basis of a movie of compassion for someone else. But in America, our priority is I am first. Our priority is me, myself, and I. We care for three people, me, myself, and I. But in reality, God is telling the people of Haggai's time, and he's telling us today, that our priority should be him first. Sure, we have houses, we have things that need to be done. And that has its place, and it will have its time, and that's okay. But the things of God, friends, whatever they are, come first. Now, tonight, we're resting in a chapel that's finished, basically. And yet, many people in this movement, they don't even have a chapel to go to. They meet in homes and places. They may not have a physical building that needs to be cared for, needs to be built. But friends, we have a spiritual household, and that spiritual household needs to be built. And the things in our lives that are the priorities for building that spiritual household, first individually in our own lives, and secondly collectively to be a resting place for the head of the church, Christ, we have a work and fear to do. And so God asks them in verse 7 of chapter 1, "Thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways." Again, he's asking them. He says, consider your ways. "Go up to the mountains and bring wood and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it, and I will be glorified, saith the Lord. He says, if you will go take care of these things, then I will bring my blessing back to you. He says, you have had a drought. In fact, if you go on in verse 9, he says, you looked for much, and lo, it came to little. And when ye brought it home, I did blow upon it. Why, saith the Lord of hosts? Because of mine house that is waste, and ye run every man into his own house. Therefore the heaven over you is stayed from dew, and the earth is stayed from her fruit. And I called for a drought upon the land, and upon the mountains, and upon the corn, and upon the new wine, and upon the oil, and upon that which the ground bringeth forth, and upon men, and upon cattle, and upon all the labor of the hands." You know, in the time of Elijah, God brought a drought upon Israel. Perhaps they were beginning to wonder if it was going to be like the time of Elijah again. But this was just over part of a year. But God was trying to wake them up. And, you know, I think in that there's a lesson. God used a year of drought to wake these people up, to be an object lesson to them. In the time of Elijah, he used 3 years of drought, actually about 3.5 years. And what that tells me is that God measures things out. And that he only does that which is necessary. If these people needed 2 years of drought, you know what? He would have given them 2 years of drought. If it would have taken 5 years of drought to have awakened them, he would have used 5 years. But fortunately, these people had some magnificent leaders in Zerubbabel and Joshua the high priest. And they had the prophets Haggai and the prophet Zechariah, who came in shortly after this. And through this good leadership, the people rallied. And they were desiring to be faithful. And so what was the response? If we look in verse 12, in the latter part of the verse, it says that you had Zerubbabel and Joshua the high priest with all the remnant of the people, and it says they obeyed the voice of the Lord their God. They obeyed the voice of the Lord their God, even before they could start to go gather this wood to build. Even before they could start compiling their plans and their ideas. It says that they obeyed the voice of the Lord because in their hearts they purposed to do what God wanted them to do. And God accounted it to them just as if they were already working. And then in verse 13, I think this is one of the most beautiful verses in all this book. "Then spake Haggai the Lord's messenger in the Lord's message unto the people, saying, I am with you, saith the Lord." In the Hebrews, just five little words there God says, but he says, "I am with you, Yahweh. I'm with you." And that's what we need today. We need the very presence of God with us today. In Isaiah chapter 41 and verse 10, he says, "Fear thou not." Why? "For I am with thee." "Fear thou not, for I am with thee." Exodus chapter 33 and verse 14. And he said, "My presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest." And Ellen White says in the book Patriarchs and Prophets on page 315, that cloud that followed the children of Israel was called the cloud of the presence because it represented the presence. It was the presence of God and that he was with them. And so the Spirit of the Lord began to stir up the people. In Haggai chapter 1 and verse 14, it says, "And the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, the son of Jehoshadak, the high priest, and the spirit of all the remnant of the people, and they came and did work in the house of the Lord of hosts, their God." The Spirit moved upon these leaders. The Spirit moved upon the remnant. And they did something. They came and they began to work on the house of God. And this then brings us down to the second message in chapter 2. And you notice it says it takes place in the 7th month and the 20th day of the month. Does anybody remember what might have been going on in Israel on the 20th day of the 7th month? Something was happening in Israel every year.
Day of Atonement? No.
No. The Day of Atonement comes just a little earlier in the month, and then comes after that what? The Feast of Tabernacles. This was during the latter part, now the Feast of Tabernacles. And you know, that should have made them think, because here they are, they're dwelling out in little temporary booths. Little temples, as it were, little places. And their hearts are grieving. There are still some of those people, as we mentioned earlier, who saw the glory of the first temple. They knew the magnificence of Solomon's temple, and now they see what they have before them. In chapter 2, verse 3, it says, "Who is left among you that saw this house in her first glory? How do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes in comparison of it as nothing?" And it was just almost like nothing compared to the first temple. But God had covenanted with those people, and he told them that he would stay with them, he would work with them, and that he was going to shake all nations if necessary to accomplish his means. In Haggai chapter 2 and verse 6, he says, "For thus saith the Lord of hosts, yet once it is a little while, and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land, and I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come, and I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. All the silver and the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts." You know, we've read that before, and we read that sometimes when we talk about stewardship. You know, everything's the Lord's, the cattle on a thousand hills are the Lord's, the gold and silver, he says, is mine. But look at the context of where this text is given. These people are starting, they have basically nothing compared to what Solomon had. They realize that they're not going to make anything like Solomon had, but God says, don't worry about this. He says, all the silver and gold is mine. If you needed more, I could give it to you. I have it. It's not for you to have to worry about. In verse 9, he says, "The glory of this latter house shall be greater than that of the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts." I think that's a pretty interesting thought. God says he's going to shake the nations, the heavens, the earth, and all that is necessary so that needs to be shaken to prepare the way for the advent of Jesus Christ. It is as if he was saying that he would shake all things and turn the world upside down and start anew, if necessary. He has all the resources to accomplish what he wishes, and the glory of the latter house will indeed be better than the former house. After the destruction of the temple by Nebuchadnezzar, it was rebuilt about 500 years before the birth of Christ by a people who, from a lifelong captivity, had returned to a wasted and almost deserted country. There were then among them aged men who had seen the glory of Solomon's temple, and who wept at the foundation of the new building, that it must be so inferior to the former. The feeling that prevailed is forcibly described by the prophet. "Who is left among you that saw this house in her first glory? And how do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes in comparison of it as nothing?" Then was given the promise that the glory of this latter house should be greater than that of the former. But the second temple had not equaled the first in magnificence, nor was it hallowed by those visible tokens of the divine presence which pertained to the first temple. There was no manifestation of supernatural power to mark its dedication. No cloud of glory was seen to fill the newly erected sanctuary. No fire from heaven descended to consume the sacrifice upon its altar. The Shekinah no longer abode between the cherubim in the most holy place. The ark, the mercy seat, and the tables of the testimony were not to be found therein. No voice sounded from heaven to make known to the inquiring priest the will of Jehovah. For centuries, the Jews had vainly endeavored to show wherein the promise of God given by Haggai had been fulfilled. Yet pride and unbelief blinded their minds to the true meaning of the prophet's words. The second temple was not honored with the cloud of Jehovah's glory, but with the living presence of one in whom dwelt the fullness of the Godhead bodily, who was God himself manifested in the flesh. The desire of all nations had indeed come to his temple when the man of Nazareth taught and healed in the sacred courts in the presence of Christ And in this only did the second temple exceed the first in glory. But you know what, friends? That one point outweighed everything else in the former. The very literal personal presence of Christ. If we go to the next slide, we have a statement from Prophets and Kings. The second temple was honored not with the cloud of Jehovah's glory, but with the presence of the one in whom dwelt all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. God himself manifest in the flesh, Colossians 2:9, 1 Timothy 3:16. In being honored with the personal presence of Christ during his earthly ministry, and in this alone did the second temple exceed the first in glory. The desire of all nations had indeed come to his temple when the man of Nazareth taught and healed in the sacred courts. And that reminds me of something that I think Anne knows something about. Because several years ago, some folks took it upon themselves to build a magnificent church building here in Wyoming County to serve the Wyoming County and McDowell County areas. And this is a pretty old picture. It doesn't show much of the magnificence of it, but it was had a sanctuary that would you could put three of these in. And the inside of it was definitely magnificent compared to this little sanctuary that we now have, as we see here in this next slide. So if you've ever wondered what Smyrna Chapel looked like, and you've never been here, now you know what the outside looks like, and now you know what a little bit of the inside looks like in our next picture. But pretty plain Jane compared to the other church. But you know what I'm thinking about tonight? I'm thinking about Haggai. And I'm thinking about what he told those people, that the glory of the latter would be greater than the glory of the former, because the glory of the latter was because the personal presence of Jesus Christ was there. Amen. And this church today, friends, knows something that that other church didn't know. We know that Jesus Christ is really the Son of God.
That's right.
And knowing that and believing that and having him come and live with us and worship with us personally, that's greater than any glory that any church, whether it's the Sligo Church in Washington, D.C., the Loma Linda Chapel in Loma Linda, or any of those big buildings that claim to have so many things could ever offer. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, he says, "What, know ye not that your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For ye are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." Do you believe that? I believe that. And you know, we read this and we generally apply it first and foremost to our physical temples. Our body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, and that's true. But the text also says that we're to glorify God not only in our body, but in our what? In our spirit. In other words, if we want God to come and dwell in our spirit, or in us, in whoever, whatever we are, this thing that we call humanity, then we have to prepare ourselves. And we have to take care of ourselves. And just as we say, you know, it's important to take care of our physical health. We don't eat certain foods. We don't drink certain things. We don't take certain products into our bodies because they're not good for us. What about our spirit and our mind? Do we read just anything and everything that comes along? It used to be you only had to worry about the mailbox. You know, that physical box that's made of metal or wood or plastic. But now we have inboxes, right? And maybe many inboxes. And they're just filled with all kinds of forwards and trash and stuff that many times we really don't need. And we fill our minds with garbage just to take a look, just to see what it's like, just to see what it is. Or we click on this video just to see what it is. And that's just about like taking the remote control on a television set and just turning it on, just clicking it around just to see what happens to be on. We're just about as likely to find something profitable. We need to be extremely careful with what goes into our minds, friends, and into our character. Now, the third message of Haggai begins in the middle part of chapter 2. The second message is the first part of chapter 2. The third message is the middle part. And this one comes now in December, around December the 18th. And in this middle section, Haggai is trying to help us understand at least two things that God is trying to impress upon us. And one is that forms of religion are not enough. And he asks, if we would turn to verse 10 there, in Haggai chapter 2, verse 10, it says, "In the 4th and 20th day of the 9th month, in the 2nd year of Darius, came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, Ask now the priests concerning the law, saying." Now you're going to ask the priest something because the priests are experts, right? They're supposed to know. So you ask them, see what they say. And here's what he says. If one bear holy flesh in the skirt of his garment, and with his skirt do touch bread or pottage or wine or oil or any meat, shall it be holy? And the priest answered and said, no. And they were correct in that. Then said Haggai, if one that is unclean by a dead body touch any of these, shall it be unclean? The priest answered and said, it shall be unclean, and according to the Levitical laws, it was unclean. And so the priests were right. And then answered Haggai and said, so is this people, and so is this nation before me, saith the Lord, and so is every work of their hands, and that which they offer there is unclean. The prophet here is giving the interpretation in these next verses. Not only the exiles themselves, but everything that they put their hands to brought a divine curse instead of a divine blessing. Their disobedience in not building the Lord's house was their pollution. And this message is definitely a reproof for their previous action. He says to them also in this that obedience is indeed necessary. I want to read these verses to you from another more modern translation. It just gives a flow of things. I think you'll appreciate it. Then Haggai continued. So this people is contaminated. Their nation is contaminated. Everything they do is contaminated. Whatever they do for me is contaminated. God says so. Think back. Before you set out to lay the first foundation stones for the rebuilding of my temple, how did it go with you? Isn't it true that your food-dragging, half-hearted efforts at rebuilding the temple of God were reflected in a sluggish halfway return on your crops, half the grain you were used to getting, half the wine? I hit you with drought and blight and hell. Everything you were doing got hit, but it didn't seem to faze you. You continued to ignore me, God's decree. And then he goes on to say, think now ahead from this same date. And remember, we're talking about from August, late August, going into September, about middle to mid-late September, when they start to actually build back on the temple again, and now until December, a very short time. He says, now think about this time, this 24th day of the ninth month. Think ahead to when the temple rebuilding was launched. Has anything in your fields, vine, fig, tree, pomegranate, olive tree, failed to flourish? From now on, you can count on a blessing. Isn't that something? Yes. In other words, before, he says, everything you did failed. But once you started to follow my plan, everything that you've done succeeded. And I think he also wants us to understand the spiritual lesson. In fact, in our next slide, we have Luke 6, chapter 6, verse 44, where it says, for every tree is known by his own fruit. For of thorns men do not gather figs, nor of a bramble bush gather they grapes. And then in Jeremiah 13, in verse 23, then may ye also do good that are accustomed to do evil. And of course, the answer is no. The answer is no. And God wants us to understand, friends, that there is an imperative that we have, and that is to be born again. Because we cannot change ourselves. Those people, they everything they touched was contaminated. Everything they did was wrong. You know why? Because they were wrong. And they needed to find God into their lives again. In John chapter 3, verse 3, Jesus said, you must be born again. And there is no way under heaven and earth we can ever do good until we first become good. And the only way to become good is by accepting Christ into our life and having him live within us. The Bible says that the carnal mind is enmity against God. It is not subject to the law of God, and neither indeed can be. It is only as we come to Christ can we hope and have any opportunity, friends, of being those good people that God wants us to be. And he does want us to be those people. If Christ dwells within us, when we have the power to do good, we have the power to do right. 1 John 4:4 says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And that is Christ in you, the hope of glory. And in the fourth message in this book, God is telling these people that he will personally work for them, not only as a nation, but also as individuals. In Haggai chapter 2, verse 20 through 23, again, the word of the Lord came unto Haggai in the 24th day of the month, and it's the same time that this third message was given earlier, saying, speak to Zerubbabel, governor of Judah, saying, I will shake the heavens and the earth, and I will overthrow the throne of kingdoms, and I will destroy the strength of the kingdoms of the heathen, and I will overthrow the chariots and those that ride in them, and the horses and their riders shall come down, every one by the sword of his brother. In that day, saith the Lord of hosts, will I take thee, O Zerubbabel, my servant, the son of Shealtiel, saith the Lord, and will make thee as a signet, for I have chosen thee, saith the Lord. I want you to notice in verses 21 and 22, all of the I's, where God's speaking. He says, I will shake heaven and earth. I will overthrow. I will destroy. I will overthrow. God's going to take the work into his own hands in these last days, friends. And he's going to do a great work for his people, but he doesn't expect them to sit back and do nothing. He expects them to participate in this work as well. But he says, I will take and I will overthrow the nations. All those people that are against you, I will deal with them. If we go to the next slide, we have these some of these verses here. And it says, I'm about to shake up everything, to turn everything upside down, start over from the bottom to top, overthrow governments, destroy foreign powers, dismantle the world of weapons and armaments, throw armies into confusion so that they end up killing one another. On that day, this is God's message. I will take you, O Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, as my personal servant. I will set you as a signet ring, the sign of my sovereign presence and authority. I've looked over the field and chosen you for this work, the message of God of the angel armies. That's what God says he's going to do. And you know what? The ancient prophets wrote, less for their time than for our time. He says that he is going to do this personally for us, that he looked upon the people and he chose Zerubbabel for this very job. He says, I've chosen you personally. I've chosen you to do a personal work for me. And tonight, he's looking at each and every one of us. He's looking at Brother Mike. He's looking at Ashley. He's looking at every one of us. And he's saying, I've chosen you for a special work. In the Review and Herald of December 19th, 1907, she says that this personal testimony of Zerubbabel has been left on record for our special encouragement in time of trial. Zerubbabel had been sorely tried through all the years since he had led the Israelites forth from Babylon. God has a purpose in sending trials to his children. He never leads them otherwise than they would choose to be led if they could see the end from the beginning and discern the glory, the purpose which they are fulfilling. He subjects them to discipline, to humble them, to lead them through trial and affliction, to see their weaknesses and to draw near unto them. As they cry to him for help, he responds saying, here am I. Christians are Christ's jewels. They are to shine brightly for him, shedding forth the light of his loveliness. Their luster depends on the polishing they receive. They may choose to be polished or to remain unpolished, but everyone who is pronounced worthy of a place in the Lord's temple must submit to the polishing process. Without the polishing that the Lord gives, they can reflect no more light than a common pebble. Friends, we are not building today a physical temple. As I mentioned, few of us even have chapels to meet within. But we are building temples for the Spirit of God to dwell in, and we are building a church or a temple where Christ collectively meets with his people. Are the upbuilding of these temples first and foremost in our lives? We think of having our healthy bodies, and we think of this in connection with 1 Corinthians 6, as we mentioned earlier. But do we also consider the need to have truth, pure doctrine, to be spiritually healthy temples for the indwelling of Christ? If we turn to God and commit ourselves fully to him, he will be with us. Remember in chapter 1 of Haggai, he says, I am with you. If we will turn to him, he promises to be with us. And he doesn't expect us to make a grand show before he promises this to us. All we have to do is give him the assent and make that purpose and dedication in our hearts. And even before we can begin the work, he says, I'm with you, and I approve of what you're doing. And you've heard my voice. You've hearkened. You know, in the Bible, hearken means to listen and to obey. And he accounts that as obedience to us. But then, of course, once he does come into our lives, and once that starts to click, he does expect us then to follow through with the action. But even before then, he accepts us. And he will send help from the four horns against all those who oppress us. We couldn't read every verse tonight, but in chapter 2 he speaks about the four horns, probably emblematic of the four directions that from every direction he sends help from. Though we have backslidden, and perhaps we have lived for ourselves, we've put ourselves first in the past, he will make us something greater and better than we used to be. Oh, you know, I know how I used to be, Brother Allen. I used to have a good experience with the Lord, and then I fell away, and, you know, the Lord can't use me now. Friends, he can do something better today. He could do something better today for you than he did even then, if you would turn your life over to him and let him. Trust him and see, because everything you've been doing till now hasn't worked. And that's what he told those people through Haggai. He says, you planted, you plowed, you did this, you did that, and nothing worked. He says, but as soon as you started following me, everything started working. But friends, it's not until we follow him with all of our heart. If we only try to follow him halfway, it won't work. As we turn to him and find the reality of his life, and not the forms of religion or the cliches of Christianity, as we are born again and bring obedience to him, our lives can change. And it's true, friends, that many things have went wrong in the past. But as we have attended to ourselves and not him, that is only what we should have expected. But as soon as we put him first, things can and will change in our lives. And that is today the message of Haggai to us. That spirit can be rekindled as we commit our lives to him today. He will subdue our enemies, and he will personally use us as his signet, for he has chosen us. He has chosen you tonight.